Good morning and welcome. Thank you for joining me. These are the readings and sermons for Sunday, December 12th, which is also the third Sunday of Advent. So let us begin. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Let us pray. Stir up the wills of your faithful people, Lord God, and open our ears to the preaching of John, that rejoicing in your salvation, we may bring forth the fruits of repentance through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from the book of the prophet Zephaniah, chapter 3, verses 14 through 20. A reading from Zephaniah. Sing aloud, O daughter Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more. On that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear, O Zion. Do not let your hands grow weak. The Lord your God is in your midst, a warrior who gives victory. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love. He will exult over you with loud singing as on a day of festival. I will remove disaster from you so that you will not bear reproach for it. I will deal with all your oppressors at that time, and I will save the lame and gather the outcast, and I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At that time I will bring you home, at the time when I gather you, for I will make you renowned and praised among all the peoples of the earth, when I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now a reading from, and our psalm this morning is a reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 12, verses 2 through 6. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my might and has become my salvation. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation. And you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord, call on God's name, make known the deeds of the Lord among the nations, proclaim that this name is exalted. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be known in all the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy, O royal Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel. Our second reading this morning comes from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7, a reading from Philippians. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now a reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 3, verses 7 through 18. John said to the crowds that came out to be baptized by him, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our ancestor, for I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. And the crowds asked him, what then should we do? In reply, he said to them, whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise. Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, teacher, what should we do? He said to them, collect no more than the amount prescribed for you. Soldiers also asked him, and we, what should we do? He said to them, do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusation, and be satisfied with your wages. As the people were filled with expectation and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to even untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. So with many other exhortations, he proclaimed the good news to the people. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from the babe of Bethlehem. Amen. The pastor of a large urban church once did a weekly TV series called The Kingdom of God. Each week on the morning after the show aired, he would visit a group of parishioners residing in an assisted living facility. On one such visit, he received an unusually enthusiastic greeting from a longtime resident. The man said, "You'll be glad to know that we all watched your TV show last night. Since there's only one TV in the rec room, we had to vote on what program we would watch. During your time slot, it came down to The Kingdom of God or The Real Housewives of Orange County. You won by one vote." Later, the pastor said, "I thought to myself that when we can beat the Real Housewives of Orange County with the Kingdom of God, we're on our way at last." I'm sure John the Baptist would agree with that. John is an amazing character, isn't he? He's certainly not what we would expect as we approach Christmas. I mean, what if riding atop the last float in the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade, there wasn't jolly old Saint Nick, but a wild-eyed John the Baptist dressed in a glorified burlap sack? Just picture that. Even the perpetually perky Katie Couric would cringe as she tries to offer parade commentary, not quite sure what to say. That's the effect John has on people. But this isn't Midtown Manhattan, and this is no Macy's extravaganza. However, our gospel lesson tells us that it has been something of a parade, though, as people trekked out to the desert to hear this strange man. He is an amazing preacher. Not many would start out the way he does. He stands before the assembled crowd, stares at them with a look of scarcely disguised disgust, and then shouts, "You are a bunch of snakes." That should get a congregation's attention. The crowd is equally amazing. After this scorching insult, they must know that it's all downhill from here, but they stay. Vipers, the wrath to come, repentance, trees cut down and burned, winnowing fork, unquenchable fire. What was John trying to do? Scare the heck out of the people, literally? And then there is Luke's remarkable conclusion to this drama. So with many other exhortations, John proclaimed the good news to the people. Good news? Does John's preaching sound like good news to you? Actually, it was and is good news. John, in his unique way, was saying, there is hope for us. We can change. We can be better, perhaps, than we ever thought possible. And to me, that is good news indeed. Now, the heart of John's message is repentance, that good old $2 church word that means not only being sorry for your sins, but being sorry enough to change and do an about face. The Greek word for repentance is metanoia, which literally means to change one's whole way of being. It's where we get our word metamorphosis from. So in that sense, repentance means to change our whole way of being, like the way a caterpillar undergoes a process of metamorphosis to become a butterfly. Now, the world outside the church says very little about repentance because the world outside the church isn't convinced that such a thing is truly possible. It says a leopard can't change its spots. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. And at this time of year, we hear a great deal about Scrooge, always a metaphor for someone who is mean-spirited and miserable. But the Scrooge of Dickens' A Christmas Carol repented, and by the end of the story becomes a generous, warm-hearted benefactor. Why do we only remember the rotten in him? Is it because the world remains unconvinced of the possibility of change? Or perhaps it is that misery loves company. If no one else can change, why should I? John says, wrong. In that context, we begin to get a better understanding of John's talk about vipers and fleeing the wrath to come. You see, John is using wilderness talk. He isn't simply in the name-calling business here, but he is calling a spade a spade. He knows that the people have traveled out to him and are ready for him to baptize them because they see it as sort of a get-out-of-hell-free card. They are trying to escape God's refining fire, just as snakes escape the desert's fire, and John says that should not happen. As wilderness fires clear out the old growth to make room for the new, John wants the people ready to have the dead grass and dead wood removed from their lives. And the word he uses for this process is repentance. But again, John isn't simply content with someone saying, "I'm sorry." Don't just talk the talk, walk the walk. John says, "Produce fruits worthy of repentance." In other words, your words might state that you've cleaned up your act and repented, but your actions and your behavior will show it. John's next comments are as applicable for today as they were for the people who stood there listening to him. He says, "Don't begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham for our ancestor,' for I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham." In other words, don't say, "This doesn't apply to me, John. I'm a church member, have been all my life." Don't say, "Well, I'm saved. I read my Bible and pray every day. I'm at church every time the doors are open. John certainly isn't talking to me." Maybe, maybe not. The truth is that more people than we care to admit like to sow their wild oats for 6 days a week, then on the seventh day come to church and pray for a crop failure. John's message is that your religion must make a difference in the way you live in the world and the way you treat people. If it doesn't, your religion isn't worth the dead grass that is burned up in a prairie fire. God is only concerned about the fruit we produce in our lives. That's why when the crowd asks him, "Okay, John, then what should we do?" He says the man with two coats should share with him who has none, and the one who has food should do the same. Tax collectors only collect what you're supposed to. Soldiers don't extort money from people. John is reteaching them how to live out their faith by following the command to love God and neighbor. Now, for those who are serious about leading lives that would please God, what John had to say offered hope. Perhaps that's why he made such a profound impression on the crowds. Could John be the Messiah? Could he be the anointed one? John says, "No one more powerful than I will come, whose sandals I am not even worthy to untie." As we move through the season of Advent and closer to Christmas, we know who John's referring to. So ready or not, here he comes, one whose winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Now, at first glance, this certainly doesn't sound like someone I would look forward to, but in the context of what John has just told us, that change is possible, that you and I can be better than we are, then the coming, the advent of this Messiah is good news indeed. But are we ready? My friends, are there things in our lives that ought not to be? Are there people who have been neglected who need our love and attention? Has life become too hectic, too wrapped up in the pursuit of passing fancies? And that is precisely why we need the season of Advent, not simply to let us know that there's a limited number of days of shopping until Christmas, but to use this time for reflection, for introspection, for taking spiritual inventory, and yes, even for change. Ready or not, Messiah is coming. Are you ready? Amen. And may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you all now and forevermore. Amen.